wasn't that much blood and gore in it.
That's the sign of a great director. He leads you to a point and let you take it the rest of the way. That's why Hitchcock was such an amazing director and so revered. You never really saw everything that you really saw in your mind. They lead you to a point, and your imagination takes it way beyond what any visual can give you. Radio does that. Radio will always do that. And radio permeates everywhere, in the workforce, in your car, at home, on your smartphone, on your computer. Radio is not a dying media. It is so good. And I wish Mike McVeigh could have been here. He had some emergencies he had to take care of back in Minneapolis with the station. And when he came to me about almost 3 years ago and said, Donnie, would you be interested in doing your own radio show? I said, yes. Can you give me some advice if we do this? And he said something that really affected me. He said, when you're talking to one person. I hope I have more people listening than one person. He said, no, you're talking to one person. You make it real. I learned this from Howard Stern. I know that may sound funny to use the names Donny Osmond and Howard Stern in the same sentence, but I was asked by Howard to do his show years ago, and they still air it once. I don't know if any of you have heard this. Every once in a while, guys would come up, Donny, I heard you on Howard Stern, but man, you're cool. My advisors, my family, my friends, everybody, when this invitation came in, said, don't do it. He'll bury you. He will make a mockery of you. I like challenges. If you want me to do something, tell me I can't do it. That's exactly what I go like. I like to climb mountains. That Howard Stern challenge was a big mountain for Donny Osmond to climb, so I said, I'm doing it. It's in New York City, waiting in the green room, and I'm sweating bullets. I'm sweating so much I got tacos under my arms, man. That is bad. I'm ready to walk out of that building thinking my friends and family and advisors were right. I'm gonna die. And then it was like an epiphany. It was like the heavens opened up, right? Two words came to my mind. Be yourself. I think what Mike McVeigh told me, talking to one person, make it real. Make the stories you're talking about real. Don't try to overdo it. When I do my radio show, I'll probably do 4 or 5 takes. Yesterday, I remember doing for the show, 4 takes on this one thing. Not to make it perfect, to make it real. Usually I'll use the first take. But that, matter of fact, that 4th take that I used, there's mistakes in it. But it was real. And there's a part in it, there's a segment in my show, we call the showbiz moment. It's experiences in my life, things I've done. And I've used this story maybe 3 times in the last 2.5 years. But it's how you tell it. It's the angle. It's the angle you create for the person listening so they can visualize what they want. Here's the story. Early 70s. I'm on tour. I'm in Paris at a hotel called the George Sank Hotel. Maybe you know the hotel. It's a very famous hotel. There's a knock at the door. I open it up. It's Paul McCartney. He's standing there with his daughter, Mary. He says, hello, Donnie, I'm Paul McCartney. I said, yeah, I know. He said, this is my daughter, Mary. She's a huge fan. She would love to get your, can I get your autograph from my daughter? Yeah. So he hands me a picture that Mary added to me, and I said, to Mary, love, Donnie Osmond. I give it to Paul. He says, thank you very much. I said, welcome. And the door closes. I walk back in the room. I think, what just happened? Fast forward to 2003, I'm in London at a video studio. I'm editing a music video. Paul is in the studio next door to me. And I'm thinking, I gotta verify this story. Maybe I made it up, maybe I dreamt it. You know how when you tell stories, they get better and better every time you tell them. I gotta verify this, so I walk in. I say, hey, Paul. I said, Donnie, how are you? And we talk, we had some pleasantries, you know, we just talked a little bit. I said, Paul, I gotta verify this story. And I related this story to him just as like I related to you. And he said, Donnie, it not only happened just like that, but it was one of the only few autographs I've ever asked for in my life. And I started thinking about that guy at the meet and greet that didn't want me to sign his picture. Paul McCartney wanted my autograph. What's wrong with you, buddy? But the reason why, I've got to wrap it up, and I'm going to wrap it up with this story. The reason why I take the time with my radio show, and sometimes do 4 or 5 dates, mostly the first date, is I pay attention to detail. I don't want it perfect, I want it real. We all know, love, respect, the talent and genius of Steven Spielberg. Do you remember the movie he did, The Color Purple? He directed The Color Purple. Do you remember that movie? Danny Glover, Oprah Winfrey was in the movie. And Quincy Jones did all the music. Quincy invited me over to the last scoring session, the sweeping session of this movie. And so I'm in there. The studio was packed with musicians. The control room is packed with people, engineers. Everybody's awaiting the arrival of Steven Spielberg. There are cameras there, they're gonna make a documentary out of this, there's lights ready to go as soon as he walks in the door. Quincy just finished this scoring, and he outdid himself, it was so beautiful. Steven walks in, lights go on, cameras start rolling. Everybody's nervous. Quincy turns to Steven and says, Steven, we just finished the last take. Sit in the producer's chair, right behind the console, and we'll play it for you. Everybody's watching Steven's face. It's kind of like that old Life commercial, is Mikey gonna like it? So he starts playing this, it's beautiful. And Steven starts smiling. And everybody's like, Mikey likes it. And after it's all over, he starts applauding. The orchestra starts applauding. Quincy's love, everybody's, oh, he loves it. We did it. Made a couple comments for the cameras. So the documentary was done. The cameras shut off, the lights shut off, everybody starts dispersing, and here's the gentleman, the professional, the genius behind Steven Spielberg. I was right behind him to hear this entire conversation. He waited until nobody was listening, and he turned to Q. Quincy was called Q. Q, do me a favor. Play it from the top. About 34 seconds in, I think there's a trombone problem. And Quincy starts laughing. He said, what? He said, I don't know, I just think there's a trombone glitch. He rewound the tape, played it from the top, 34 seconds into it, soloed the trombone tracks. Sure enough, a trombone, one trombone player, played a wrong note. That's paying attention. You're all in radio. I don't care if you're doing a 30-second spot, 15-second spot, 5 seconds. I don't care if you're doing a sound effect for a spot. Make it the best you can. Pay attention to detail. I learned so much from that moment from Steven Spielberg, not to be perfect, because he let it go. I remember telling Quincy, just mix it in, nobody will ever know. But he paid attention to detail. I love being in radio. I think it's so much fun. I hope I can do this a long, long time. And I appreciate the invitation to being here today. I hope you have a great time. I'd love to spend all day here. I've got to get to the Flamingo. I have a little vocal booth that I put in my dressing room. That's where I do my radio show. And then I got to get ready to do this show with this chick named Marie. But it's been fun being here. I really love being a part of this community, a part of this organization. So thank you very much for allowing me to be here. Have a great day.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think I have known of Donny Osmond most of my life. And I've been privileged to be his friend for a number of years now. As I listen to him and I consider all my memories of Donny Osmond, I thought of his fame, his fortune, his longevity, and now his membership among us in radio. And yet of all the success he's enjoyed, the thing that stood out to me is he mentioned his wife of many, many years, his 5 sons. And there's no greater American success story than a successful family. So, Donny Osmond, congratulations. Thank you for all you've done. Another round of applause. Now this is going to be fun. Every year, NAB recognizes an individual or program with an induction into the NAB Broadcasting Hall of Fame. These are men and women and the programs that have profoundly shaped the history of radio. The list, however, simply would not be complete without this legendary radio baseball announcer. He first entered the baseball scene as an athlete, signing on to play with his hometown team, the Milwaukee Braves. After 6 years of playing in Major League Baseball, he built a steady and successful career appearing in TV commercials, situation comedies, and movies. You might remember his humorous appearances in Major League and Major League 2, the hit ABC television series, Mr. Belvedere, and many Miller Lite commercials. But it is on the radio that he has found a lasting home. His self-deprecating humor, his very warm and rich voice, the energetic play-by-play have become synonymous with baseball season to loyal Milwaukee baseball fans for more than four decades. In his play-by-play coverage on the Brewers radio network and the Journal Broadcasting Group's WTMU in Milwaukee, he connects with his listeners to what's happening on the field, describing everything from how green the grass is to where the ball is hit. To his achievements as an actor, athlete, and pitchman, he has added the legacy of a great radio baseball announcer. He will always be Mr. Baseball. Please direct your attention to the screens for a look at Bob Uecker's career.
Mr. Baseball, this year marks his 41st behind the mic as the voice of the Brewers. As a broadcaster, he's a legendary figure, and that's a good thing, because as a ball player, not so much.
He's had the strength to continue to have a career in baseball as an announcer, despite the embarrassment of having a lifetime batting average of 200. There aren't many in the game who can, you know, point to such incredible mediocrity as being the basis of further success.
It was fun to watch as a player, but you didn't get a chance to watch him throw. Amazingly, Bob did hit Sandy Koufax, and I have to give him credit for that. Problem is, he didn't hit anybody else.
After Uecker's playing days were over, Bud Selig, then the owner of the Brewers, had an interesting idea about what Bob might do next.
He was funny, he was knowledgeable, he was from Milwaukee, and he really made a great impression on everybody. I remember talking to Bob Elan over at Schlitz and saying, this guy could be a wonderful announcer someday, and finally I got him to take him part-time. He became one great announcer.
I can't think of too many things in Bob's life that are more important than being a broadcaster. He loves to share. He loves to tell stories. He loves to invite you into his mind for a baseball game. Even better, he invites you into his slightly deranged mind to have a wonderful time.
Sioux Nationals placed Ian Desmond. Fraternity leave, I almost fell over. He didn't show anything when we were watching.
Bob has a wonderful style. He can be very dramatic. Kid a lot. He knows the market very well. He really resonates with our fans. He has a great relationship. And Bob's fun to listen to. He always finds things to amuse either himself or you or anybody else. And when there's high drama, there's nobody any better than Bob.
He's probably one of the most naturally funny people to be produced in our country in the last half century. In fact, Johnny Carson told me once, he felt that Bob was the most naturally funny person he'd ever met, that all of these great witticisms, jokes, and remembrances that pour out of Uecker in any television appearance he's ever had, none of them have ever seen a writer's pen or pencil.
Somebody gave me some pictures tonight. Are these some of the highlights?
Yes.
Obviously, it's a locker room celebration.
No, this is actually a picture of me getting ready for a game.
When I broadcast.
Yeah.
You know, there are a lot of times I work naked in the booth.
I didn't know.
And you don't want people watching me.
I don't want
the guy.
Sure.
But I don't want a lady coming in there. It's a little tough. You got to watch out when I work like that. July and August, really hot.
Yeah, of course.
So
you already come.
I want to be comfortable.
Right.
But you got to watch out during the national anthem and. maybe the seventh inning stretch.
That's right.